I believe we are live. This keeps on getting better every week. I hope you enjoyed that little preparation video that we've prepared now. I am here. First of all, my name is Dennis Kim. I'm the Concertmaster of your Pacific Symphony. And I have the great pleasure of welcoming Rob Istad, who is the music director of the Pacific Chorale.
Thanks for having me, Dennis. It's so great to see you. Thank you for inviting me.
It's great to see you. And I was talking to you, and when we were looking for different guests for this mixer, I was talking about our relationship, the Pacific Symphony relationship with the Pacific Symphony Chorale. I've been in different orchestras, not only in America, but all over the world. And when I first got here, to be honest, it was a little strange. When Pacific Symphony went to Carnegie Hall, they brought the choir. When we have these huge galas, we have the choir. And I was like, what's the deal? Why are the two organizations so close? But our music director and Rob, I think the collaboration between these two organizations is incredible. We have a mutual respect. And I really feel that Carl feels that when we have something important, our partners, Pacific Chorale, should be with us on stage. And it's been great to perform with them and to work with Rob. So I'm glad you're here today. And hopefully this will be fun, a fun hour of just talking.
Well, I'm excited to be here too. And I just have to tell you how much I cherish the relationship that Pacific Chorale has with Pacific Symphony. I mean, we're more than sisters. I mean, we're like family, you know, more than sister organizations. And I've grown up with the Chorale and grown up with Carl and with all of your colleagues who I love, you know, and there's something very special about getting to know the personnel in a musical organization as deeply as we all know one another. I think it lends itself to a different kind and a different level of music making. And I think that's evident specifically in these amazing performances that we have shared.
Right. No, it's really a special bond. And like I said, you know, when Carl had a chance to go to Carnegie Hall, I mean, he could have programmed anything. And to bring Pacific Symphony Chorale, I think it was a huge testament to not only the level of the choir, but of the importance of the two organizations. Like always, please, those of you joining us, please send in your questions for Rob or I, or for anything, for either of us or both of us. We're here to try to answer as many questions as possible. The first question I have is, so like I said, I've worked with choirs everywhere. And in Korea, it's a little different. In Europe, it's a little different. And I understand in America, it's a little different. But your Pacific Chorale, how many musicians are, first of all, professionals? How many have a music training background? And how many are just amazing amateurs?
Most of the chorales had training in music. So we have about 240 musicians on our roster, and that's because we're so busy. So we're one of the busiest choral organizations in the country. I think every year we have something like 187 calls in a normal year. And so trying to get all these various contingencies of people to do everything would be very difficult. Yeah, 187 calls, Christian. And so what we do is we've set up this whole system of staffing our choirs that pairs a specific amount of professional singers, professional audition singers, we call them staff singers, with our wonderful volunteer singers. Most of our volunteer singers are professional music educators. We have a lot of music teachers in the choir, lots of fellow conductors, which I love, church choir conductors and community choir conductors and high school and middle school, grade school musicians. So it's really inspiring to bring all those people together. There are, of course, people that have had musical training and maybe have chosen to go into the corporate world. I love those people, our lawyers and our doctors, and we've had machinists that come, people that work in factories, and bringing all of those people together to create that kind of artistic product is really inspiring to me. For the concerts that we sing together, Dennis, typically we have 32 staff singers on the concert, mixed with the remainder being really talented volunteers.
Well, it's amazing because as you may or may not know, in Korea, it's a fully professional orchestra. And so the level is incredibly high. But what I heard is, you know, the chemistry is not always the best because there are just too many cooks in the kitchen. But then when you get to the concert, you can imagine they're all 100% professional and all trained in Europe or in America. So it's a different beast altogether in Korea. And then in Europe, of course, it's a little bit, everyone is there as a volunteer. And some people actually pay to be in the choir. So that was also very interesting, working with the orchestras in Finland. Again, also very high level and very dedicated musicians. I mean, the choirs all over the world are amazing. And I haven't, I mean, not only because of COVID, because I haven't been here too long, but when I see the choir backstage, it just seems like the nicest group of people. They're very supportive. It's friendly, welcoming. And so every time I've had a chance to work with you guys, Messiah, and we've done some opera together already, it's always been very special. So once this COVID finishes, which is hopefully very soon, I can't wait to be back on stage. What have you been doing during Corona lockdown?
Well, you're seeing my cave back here. This is my office at home. Before I answer that question, Dennis, I just want to tell you again how excited we all were that you chose to share your artistry with us in Southern California. I was so thrilled and so excited to meet you and to work with you and to witness your amazing leadership of our colleagues. I am truly inspired by you and grateful to have that opportunity to be with you musically anytime that I can. I don't care whether I'm preparing a choir or I'm on the podium or I'm just there listening to you. I just want you to know that.
Oh, thank you, Rob. I mean, it is different because I've seen you come to concerts and your choir's not there, you're not conducting, and you come backstage and really this kind of family-like atmosphere is really something special. And I appreciate it. All the musicians appreciate it. I know Carl loves you, so. Again, that's too much of that. Come on, stop it. Okay, what have you been doing during COVID?
What I've been doing. So I've been back here. This is my home office. They've made me take the art off the wall behind me because I use it to film various videos when they need like a white screen behind me. But, you know, I'm a full-time professor at Cal State Fullerton, and then I'm also full-time at Pacific Chorale. So I have two full-time jobs. And then I serve on a number of different service organizations around the country. So I've spent a lot of time back here on my computer working. I saw that Christian Amundsen is on this call. So working with him to produce virtual performances, I've been teaching and attending board meetings. I mean, you name it. I mean, when I get to leave this room, that's when I go out and I do things outside and stuff like that. But basically I've been in here and
it's been crazy. Yeah, we talked about it right before we started, but I would love for you to just talk about what, you know, your feelings about just sitting in front of a computer all the time.
Yeah, I have to tell you that as crazy as this has been, it's given me a really new perspective. There are so many people around the world that this is their life. You know, they sit in front of a computer, and we're grateful that they do that because they provide us so many amazing services and amazing luxuries and essential, very essential things that we all need to live and survive. But I have to tell you that being here has given me this perspective of gratitude for what you and I get to do, that we live in this really strange analog world, you know, where I open a book and I use a tuning fork and we make music together, you know, that we live in that very special world. And it's helped me to realize that what we do is more essential than ever. Because there's nothing more, I think, that I want right now than to connect with people musically, than to be with people, yeah. You know, and it makes me more passionate about bringing what we do to all of these wonderful people that are living like this every day behind a computer to inspire them to walk away from it, you know?
No, when we were talking about that before, I was like, no, save that stuff because, you know, it's when you said it the first time and also now it just gives me chills because it's true. I mean, I spend time in front of the computer now because of COVID, but before I checked ESPN, I checked Facebook, and I did recommendation letters. I did emails once in a while. That was it. And then everything else, you know, you're practicing, you're going to rehearsals, you're performing. So, you know, to think of people who are in front of a computer 9 hours a day, every day of their lives, like you said, it's something amazing. And like you said, you know, we're very grateful for what they do, but I can't wait to get out from behind this computer and back on stage and to be performing and be performing with you guys.
One of my favorite things, Dennis, is when I do get to prepare a choir for you and for Carl or whoever's the guest conductor, I get to sit out in the audience and I come to every single performance. And my favorite thing to do is to just sit and look down the row right as you all begin to play and to watch the look on people's faces, that look of like transcendence and wonder and excitement and anticipation and to see that, and then to watch them when Pacific Rail stands up and then start singing, you know, like in Beethoven 9, they've been sitting, they've been, you know, and it's truly extraordinary to watch what you do for people. And I think right now, what we're living through right now makes me more passionate than ever to give that experience to as many people in our community as we possibly can.
Yeah, I mean, I keep on bringing my time when I was in Finland, but I when I was there, I was obviously on a working visa, and you get the working visa at the police station. It's very strange. But so I applied for just the extension of my visa, and the lady that was dealing with my application, she was very shy, and I gave her all the paperwork, and she said, "I go to your concerts every week." I was like, "Oh, great." And she was like, "So I work Monday to Friday, and then I go to your concert Friday night, and that is my work week, and that's just my life." And you sometimes forget that it's, you know, what we do on stage is so important to so many people. And during this time, you know, when we're not on stage, I know a lot of people are struggling, not only financially and health-wise, but just this not being able to go to concerts, shows, movies, and these kind of things. And it's so I can't wait to be back on stage, and hopefully it's sooner rather than later. We have a question that's very, very specific, actually. In 2009, Rob prepared the choir for the Disney Symphonic Legacy Concert at Disney Hall, featuring Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Do either of you have an interest in performing this in the concert piece?
Well, we love Disney, and that was a magical concert. Oh my gosh. I mean, I think that was the concert when I got to meet Julie Andrews. I talk about an amazing moment. My goodness, I was over the moon with that. And it was really fun. You know, that was actually it was a really beautifully done piece, because they pieced together the original score from the original film, and they had actors, and it was really special. So
I mean,
especially for children, my nephew would love it. I bet your kids would love it.
I think both of us would love to do that. As you can imagine, and we talked about this beforehand also, choir is going to be probably one of the last things that comes back. So in your humble opinion, when do you come back to perform with the Pacific Symphony, in your opinion?
Well, as soon as it is safe to do so. I will be the first person in line. When they tell me I can go get that vaccine, I will sleep outside. If I slept outside for the premiere of the first of the new Star Wars movies, which was a disaster when I was in college, I would stand and sleep outside to get this vaccine, because it just provides so much hope. You know, it's when we can safely gather a community together and produce aerosols, which we do when we sing at incredible velocity. As soon as we can do that, we will. I'm hoping that we can do something outside as soon as late spring, early summer this year. You know, if our wonderful people can our wonderful scientists and all the medical professionals and the government can get their collective brains together and get this vaccine rolled out, boy, it would certainly make a huge difference for us. And I can't wait to perform with the symphony again. I mean, wouldn't that be fabulous if we could do something outside in the summer?
Right.
You know, that's the safest place, is to sing outside. If we have vaccinated singers and musicians of the symphony, boy, imagine what we could do.
Right. I mean, I think that, your organization and Pacific Symphony, we're trying our best. We're just waiting for the green light from the government. And because like you said, safety is first. I mean, we need these concerts and we miss these concerts, but we're not going to, you know, risk our lives to come to these concerts. Just a little bit about your background. First of all, how long have you been with the Pacific Symphony Chorale? And are you originally from this area? Let our audience know a little bit about you.
Okay, so this will be very nutshell, but I've been artistic director of Pacific Chorale. This is my fourth season. This Fermata COVID season is my fourth season. I was the associate conductor before then for about 5 years, and I'd been the assistant conductor for about 7 years before that. So it's amazing. I moved to California to study conducting with John Alexander, who is the former artistic director. And at that point, I applied for and received a job as the director of operations for Pacific Chorale, which was actually really invaluable while I was in graduate school. So I worked as the operations manager of the chorale and got to work with all of the staff of the symphony. I got to know Jim Medvitz and all of the people backstage. And it was really kind of interesting to get that perspective on things before I became a professional conductor. Before that, Dennis, I grew up in Northern Illinois, outside of the city of Chicago, in a town called Rockford. And I went to college as a pre-med student, so with a piano scholarship. So I was trained as a pianist, and I played in orchestras my whole life. So I played orchestral percussion, trap set. So I played drum set. I played orchestral piano. I was actually in the union in my hometown, which is hysterical, but played with the local pops orchestra when I was in school, and it was great. And so when I went to college, I thought, as a piano major, as a piano scholarship recipient, they said I had to have an ensemble. So I thought, well, I've got to go and audition for the orchestra conductor. And that's when I found out that only students that were actually majors got to play in the orchestra. So then I went to the band director. I was like, well, I could play in the band. Nope. You know, only majors could play in the band. And I went to this little Lutheran school called Augustana College, who had a very good pre-med program, which is why I was there. And Norwegian parents, maybe a lot like your parents, very focused on their child's success. And I was going to be this medical doctor. And they forced me to sing in the choir, Dennis. I was very angry. So I went, they said, you have to go audition for the choir director. And I said, I'm not going to do that. You know, I'll play in the orchestra, but that's, so I went to the department chair and he said, sir, I'm sorry. I went all the way up to the president's office. And they finally said, young man, you will sing in that choir. And then I went to the choir director's office and they made me sight read. And as a pianist, I was like, oh yeah, I can do that. Especially my rhythmic sight reading was great. And then my tonal was pretty good. And they said, yeah, you're going to be in the choir that meets every day for an hour. And I thought, are you kidding me? Like, I'm a med student. And I'll tell you, day one, I fell in love. It was the wildest thing. I mean, I'll never forget that day. So
we have a question from David. What are the most challenging choral works to prepare?
Let's see.
this is tough. I mean, there must be a thousand, but
well, every preparation is a challenge, because what you want to do is prepare the chorus to be as flexible as possible, obviously accurate and flexible and attuned to the artistry of the musical leadership on the podium. So you can't prepare them to do the same thing all the time. You have to, and that's a real skill to learn how to do that. But I would definitely say Mahler 8, I've prepared that now 3 times. And I think that's a challenge, primarily just because there are so many different factions of different ensembles that are together to sing that. It's very complicated, I think, to get a unified sound and accuracy. I think that crazy a cappella section and the Ravel Daphnis and Chloe is a real marker of a really good ensemble. And that one, I prepared that for Esa-Pekka and for Dudamel, actually for Gustavo's first concert with the Phil as the music director, was that wonderful performance. And that's a real challenge to get the choir to inspire them to be in tune. For Carl, we premiered, before you were here, Bill Bolcom's Prometheus Piano Concerto.
With choir.
That talk about a challenge. That was something else. That was very interesting. So, but I think that, you know, preparing a choir to sing Baroque music for a conductor is difficult, because the style is so indelibly linked to whoever the person is on the podium. You know, you don't ever have enough time to talk with a guest conductor about what they want. That's the great thing about being with Carl, is I really have a sense of what he really wants from the choir. Did that answer the question?
I think so. So I know, especially because we're a little bit away from live concerts, I know you have some clips that our audience is probably dying to hear. Sure. Set up your first clip for us, Rob.
Well, I thought, because this is a Pacific Symphony event, we should play something from our shared history together. And what better than Carmina Burana, right? The Carl Orff Carmina Burana. And so we get to hear the opening chorus, O Fortuna, with Carl on the podium. And, oh, I have to be allowed to share my screen though, Alexi, or I won't be allowed to do this. You have to make me a co-host. And as there, I am the co-host now. So let's see. I'm going to. Google Chrome.
One of our staff usually takes care of all this, but Rob decided he's going to do it.
Hey, I live on Zoom now, everybody. So here we go. Hopefully you can see Carmina Burana. And I'll.
So many parts of that gives me chills. First of all, the sound, of course, but to see the audience, a full audience, is amazing. To see my colleagues giving 100%, and to see Carl using that much energy, and for those, I mean, many of you have not seen him, of course, in rehearsal, he gives that kind of energy in the rehearsal. From first rehearsal to the last concert, that's the kind of energy he gives. And yeah, like I said, it just gives me chills. The choir sounded amazing. And I've had a chance to do that all over the world. But when the choir is that prepared and when you have a conductor who believes in that music that much, it was a very special week of concerts. And yeah, thank you for sharing that. It was amazing.
It was fun. And I could see you down there. I could see you playing. I wish the camera had been on the other side. I love Meredith, but it would have been nice to see a little bit of you too.
No, and there's a few people in the front row just smiling the whole time. It's just amazing.
I know.
And you saw Meredith looking up a little bit. I do that all the time when the choir is there. Yep. Because all the orchestra members, I promise you, have our favorite choir members. We look up there. We don't know their names, but the way they sing, I mean, we can't really hear individual singers. I think that's probably a good thing. But we have our favorites just visually and how involved they are. So I can't wait to be back on stage with them. And yeah, thank you for sharing that clip.
Me too. Me too.
I have one question, and it kind of meshes with this question. So in your 4 years here, have you been involved in any commissions? But Rick has a question. Who are some of the modern composers that you are interested in? So
we've been a part of a number of commissions. We have a composer in residence, Tarek O'Regan. He is an American-British composer. Used to live in Manhattan, now lives in San Francisco. In fact, we just released an album of many of his works from throughout his life. We played, Dennis, I think you were here, and we played his piece, A Celestial Map of the Sky. Maybe, I don't know if it might have been, my first year, which you weren't here.
Yeah, a little before, yeah.
And that was really an extraordinary piece of music. His piece, The Ecstasies Above, really changed my perspective on rhythm and music, and choral music specifically. And so it was really, really neat to be able to record that. I love Caroline Shaw. We were set to premiere a piece by her, Dennis, together last May. Really interesting piece, and she was going to come. And we had a piece premiere by Frank DeKelly on the same program, which was great. So I'm really intrigued. I'm intrigued by Caroline's music a lot. I'm intrigued by Tarek's music. There's a woman in Estonia, Galina Grigorieva, who's writing some really interesting pieces and sort of based in Orthodox chant that I'm really fascinated with. Again, I was supposed to give a premiere of a piece of hers in March, 2 days before we shut, or 2 days after we shut down. So I love, you know, people still consider Stravinsky modern music. He's one of my very favorite composers. Right. One of my favorite things in the whole wide world is his Les Nos. I really love Oedipus Rex. I'd love for us to do that together. I know you probably don't like Symphony of Psalms, but I love Symphony of Psalms, but no violins. That's the thing about Symphony.
No, I love Stravinsky.
But I do love it. Yeah.
So I have the Dushkin Strad, and Samuel Dushkin was a colleague of Stravinsky, and a lot of Stravinsky's music was premiered on this violin. So when I play Stravinsky, I mean, there's some spirit in my violin that brings Stravinsky out. So no, I have a very soft spot in my heart for Stravinsky. I mean, Firebird, Petrushka, all this stuff is some of my favorite stuff. Again, this is a very specific question/comment, but have you conducted any of Donald Michalski's works?
Donald Michalski. Yes. Yeah, he was a faculty member at Cal State Fullerton.
Exactly, he was founding member at Cal State Fullerton, and Mr. Beck has studied with him between 60 and 69. Have you conducted any of his works?
He has a piece, Mr. Beck, that's called The Wheel of Time for wind ensemble and chorus. And actually my colleague, Dr. Dustin Barr at Cal State Fullerton, we've talked about wanting to present that work. We were really focusing on trying to present works of our colleagues that are living right now. So Pam Madsen and Ken Velitsky and those wonderful people at Fullerton, we really wanted to do that. But yeah, The Wheel of Time was definitely on our list.
And one of my favorite people, Rosalind Britton, asks, would you please both request that our first in-person concert be a choral and orchestral concert? It'd be a hugely emotional event. I mean, if it wasn't COVID and if it was just some other lockdown, I think coming back with Mahler's Seconds, Resurrection would be ideal. But I don't think that's going to happen, Rosalind. I think, like I said, our first in-person concert, if it's indoors anyways, it will not be with choir because of all these safety issues. But if some reason it's the vaccines work and we're all back to normal, I would definitely ask you and Carl and John and Eileen, I would love to do Mahler's Second. I know Carl loves Mahler. I think the choir would be amazing. And like you say, Rosalind, I think it would be hugely emotional.
It would be a dream. Are you kidding? I mean, I think the best thing, Dennis, I've heard about coming out of this situation, this COVID situation, that it's going to be like a dimmer switch and not a light switch. We're not going to be able to go boom, Mahler 8, Mahler 2. You know, I think what's going to happen is, you know, we're going to have some instrumental programs, and then we're going to have some chamber choir instrumental programs, and things gradually opening up in the safest way possible.
Yeah, and unfortunately, in that dimmer, I believe the choir stuff is right at the top of the dimmer.
Especially the big choir stuff.
Exactly.
But I do have hope. I mean, my friend Dwayne Wolf, who's the conductor of Chicago Symphony Chorus, they have scheduled a Cherubini Mass. Riccardo Muti has a Cherubini Mask on to open this mask. Where's my brain? A Cherubini Mass on to open their season. and they're negotiating with the Singers Union and AGMA and spreading people out and singers masks. And so if Chicago can figure it out in a really safe way, you know, maybe they can.
No, if they can do it, we can do it. I mean,
we're talking about September.
A lot of organizations are learning from each other, and I think learning from each other's mistakes also. But I think that, if they can do it, I think we can do it. And Rosalind, I hope you understand our desire to do that kind of big music. Would be amazing with choir. I've gotten so many texts, but can you please share another clip? Oh, and sure. By the way, so I know with different internet situations, sometimes it can be a little laggy, but Alexi will post in your chat where you can find these. I think a lot of these are on YouTube. So, yes. Can you set up your next clip for us, Rob?
Sure. I think that the next clip, which I think would be really meaningful for all of us today, since we're talking about new music, is a piece by Tarek O'Regan, our composer in residence. It's a piece for unaccompanied chorus. The name of the piece is All Things Common. And I had the opportunity to premiere this piece a few years ago, and we recorded it. Our album is called All Things Common. And the sentiment behind it, which I find really special, especially in this crazy time we're all living through, is that a divided kingdom will not stand. But when we realize we have all things common, we tend to love each other and connect. And we're all far more alike, I think, than we are different. And the sentiment behind it is just is very lovely. So the piece features our soprano section leader, Becky Haskett, in the opening. It's a short a cappella work, but I hope that you find it as moving as I do. And the text is from the Old Testament. And now I am.
And
It's beautiful, my goodness. I don't know this work, and it's, wow, it's haunting. It's beautiful. Oh, I can't hear you. Are you there? There you are.
I'm here. I have to turn off. I have a microphone up here. I have to turn off when I play excerpts. Otherwise, you get this double sound.
Right.
Anyway, I'm glad you like it. Beautiful. And I know it's contemplative and it's kind of, but I thought maybe we could use just a little moment.
No, it's perfect. I think it's a perfect day and a perfect time for that kind of music. So Mr. Dennis Lambert has a great question, and we might talk about this for the rest of the hour, but do you ever get bored doing repetitive concerts? For example, Handel's Messiah every Christmas season. And I'm going to start with this. It's not fun playing Messiah. I'm going to be honest with you. And when I see it on the calendar every year, I'm like, oh man, I dread it. And then the first rehearsal, it's something magical. And then we rehearse it, and there's always slightly something different, a different tempo, a different soprano, the choir does something different. And then the first concert, you see somebody in the audience who's never heard it before, and the twinkle in their eye, and you're like, that's why we do Messiah every year. I fully understand the question, but the reason that some of these pieces are famous are because they're amazing. Why is Beethoven's Fifth amazing? Why is, we can go through any of these pieces, but that's why I think we do Handel's Messiah every Christmas. Not only because it's amazing music, and not only because people love to hear it, but it's famous for a reason. Sorry, I hope I didn't answer the question all by myself, but Rob, please.
You answered the question. You know that piece that piece has been performed every single year since the year it was actually composed? Every year. It has never not been performed on this planet for every year in its existence. There is no other piece of music that can stand up to that record. And there's something magical about it.
Yeah, exactly. And to ask you, Mr. Lambert, what would you rather hear during Christmas? Or do you have any suggestions? Because I think we're all ears. I mean, we can do Messiah and something that you guys would like to hear. But I think that Messiah is something really magical. And that's the reason we do it. I'm really glad that we got to listen to some new music, and there's some questions about new music, because I think it's important to continue to commission music. When I lived in Europe, almost every concert, there was one piece that was brand new. And I understand the situation is a little bit different in America. We can't do that because people will stop coming to concerts, and then we'll go bankrupt, and then there'll be no more orchestra. But in Finland and in many parts of the world, it's fully subsidized by the government. So didn't matter if people came to the concert or not. Of course, people did come to the concert, and in some ways even more so, but that's why the music director's there. They have a little more license to program what they like. And without exaggeration, in a season, you would play 10 pieces that I'd never played before, never heard before. So this is something that's very special. And I'm glad that you are a champion of new music, and you commission new music, and you believe in new music, because I think it's very important.
Well, supporting living artists is what we should be doing. It's our responsibility. And my favorite thing to do, Dennis, is to program a piece of new music alongside a beloved piece that people may know really well. So they might be drawn to this very interesting pairing. You know, they might really enjoy hearing, I don't know. I mean, what have I done that was interesting that we paired? What do we put with the, with the Brahms Requiem, we put the paired Te Deum with that piece. But I think it's really interesting. And sometimes a couple of my colleagues have actually commissioned composers to respond to a piece in the canon, that they, write a response to this piece. And some really magical things have happened because of that. Caroline Shaw wrote the most beautiful compliment to Buxtehude's, monumental cantata, Membra Jesu Nostri. And it's a great piece that stands right alongside the Buxtehude, and it's lovely. So I think there's a real opportunity. And I'm also really proud that Pacific Symphony commissions so many composers, that we've had so many wonderful collaborations. And we were supposed to have this wonderful collaboration with a new piece by Sir James McMillan. which I think we still will.
Yeah.
Just delayed.
Exactly. Yeah, it's because Mr. Lambert continues. I mean, he's not suggesting that we don't do it, but what do you do to make it a bit different each year? Again, they might be very subtle differences that the audience might not pick up right away, but I know at the Pacific Symphony, you do it one Christmas, and then we have a guest conductor one Christmas, and then we just rotate. Mm-hmm. And so the 2 years I've been here, I did it once with Rob, and I did it once with Christopher Warren Green.
English. He was wonderful. My gosh.
You came to both those concerts, that's two different pieces, different tempos, different articulations, different everything. I mean, in some ways, it was unrecognizable. Both very special in its own way, but completely different. So that's what we do. That's what we try to do, to try to keep it live and fresh. I mean, we try not to repeat the same pieces and do it the exact same old way all the time. So thank you, Mr. Lambert, for your continued support. And we hope you can come to our Messiah whenever we get a chance to do it again.
Yeah, you know, and I think there's something really wonderful about having an annual tradition like that, where people can show up and they can sort of curl up with a favorite book, with a favorite piece of art. You know, when I lived in Northern Illinois, I would drive to Chicago so that I could go to the Art Institute, and I would sit in front of the Chagall Windows on America. And I would just look at them, and I'd seen it. I can't tell you how many times I'd seen that piece, but I would find something new in it every time. And I loved that. And I love that about returning to beloved pieces, these pieces like Mendelssohn Elijah, you know, and Beethoven 9. I mean, every time we perform that piece together, I hear something different and I see something different.
Right. No, it's this is something that I wanted to say last before we went back to the Messiah. But so I have a lot of composer friends who hate being on concerts with just new music. They want to be part of a concert where, you know, they're up against the Beethoven, up against the Brahms, up against Schubert, so that the audience can hear the differences. And I hope going forward there's many more concerts with new music from living composers. Composers of women, compositions of women, of minorities. I mean, there's so many things we can do. And I think when we get back on stage, I think we should take advantage of the opportunity to expand our repertoire. Please continue sending your questions. Otherwise, me and Rob will be talking about the pros and cons of pickleball that we were talking about earlier. Rob's a big fan of pickleball. I think that I have to be a certain age to start pickleball. So please send in your questions. For me, I'm going to be honest with you now. So there was some discussion if we should have this mixer today because of the situation in our capital. But I think we both agreed that this is very important that we're doing this to give us a chance to keep our minds off those events, but also to have something that we can look forward to. And I'm grateful that you took time to do this, and I think this was the right thing to do.
I do too, and it keeps our minds on what's important, on connecting with people. That's what I love about being the artistic director of Pacific Chorale, because every week, and I miss this terribly, 2 to 3 times a week, I'm standing in front of 140, 160 people, all who believe slightly different things about lots of different things in this world. And to watch them come together, breathe the same air, create harmony, create friendships that transcend those differences, and watch them understand each other and love each other and lift each other up. It is the most inspiring, most hope-filled thing you can do in your life. And when you add the Pacific Symphony to that, when you get, you know, sometimes 300 people on that stage together, that couldn't be more different. Artistically, you know, politically, religiously, and to bring them together and to create art, I think that sews together a community in the most special way. And it's a shining example to the world, and it always has been. It's a shining example to the world, though, of what is possible when we just listen and we work together.
Exactly. I mean, not only at the beginning of this pandemic, but even after 9/11, I remember thinking as a musician, I'm like, I mean, what I do is so insignificant. I mean, there are people dying and this chaos. But I remember the first concerts back from 9/11, it was so many people came. And that was a time when so many people after the concert would come backstage and tell you that was so important. Thank you for doing this. I mean, we need to get back to normalcy. And same with the Yankees when they played, you know, and, you know, they could have canceled the week or even the season, but, you know, they got back Yankee Stadium and playing because it's important. I think, you know, to give us a connection to something that's normal and what we love, I think this is important. So I'm really grateful that we didn't cancel and that we're here today to talk and chit chat about music and stuff we love. Miss Gibson. So I'm Dennis Kim. I'm the Concertmaster Pacific Symphony, but this is Rob's hour. So please go to the second mixer. I think I'm the guest there. So you'll learn as much as you want to know about me there. I think I'm Korean Canadian, but I've been Concertmaster Pacific Symphony for the last 2 years, and I've been here and there. So, but anything else you want to know, please go to the one of the earlier mixers. So Christian, your colleague has a question. What traditions does Pacific Chorale have, not counting Saya, maybe rehearsal tradition or special Pacific Chorale quirks?
What are the Pacific Chorale quirks? Interesting.
Is there something that you guys do that another choir doesn't do, or a certain way you rehearse, or something different that the Pacific Chorale does?
That's funny that you say that. I mean, I think Pacific Chorale is unique in how close we all are. It's not just an ensemble, it's a family. We're very social. So we have these little happy hours after rehearsal quite often that are sometimes actually like put together by members, and sometimes they're just sort of informal where we rehearse in Newport Beach. And so you just hop over to the Yard House and everybody has a beer after rehearsal together. We travel together. We've gone on a number of European tours, Asian tours, South American tours. And that's a really fun moment. People bring their entire family along, you know, and you get on a bunch of buses and you're traveling all over and giving concerts with orchestras, you know, from that country. And it's a really fun way to get to know each other. And we have a bunch of wild stories that I cannot share on this program. You would have to come to one of our happy hours to hear some of these crazy tour stories. And this is what they keep begging me, you know, when we get back, the singers keep saying, when are we going on tour? Where are we going to go? You know, they're itching to go and misbehave somewhere together in a musical way, not misbehaving, but otherwise.
Of course, misbehaving musically only.
Yeah, of course, musically, top notch. So, and priorities for us when we get back in person, to do something new together, to right, Dennis? I mean, I will never take a rehearsal for granted ever again. In fact, I am ashamed of sometimes that I would be on the freeway yet again, on my way down, you know, going, oh, I'm so tired, you know? And I'm just opening up to you honestly about that, because I will never feel that way again. You know,
everyone agrees. I mean, not only in Pacific, but every musician or every artist, they'll never take it for granted again, at least the first year.
But exactly.
I mean, really, like the first rehearsal, I think everyone's going to get there an hour early to socially distance and not talk, but just to see each other and to be on the same stage to make music. I mean, this is stuff that we took for granted our whole lives. And now, you know, when we get back, I think, like you said, it's going to be so special for all of us. And again, I can imagine equally for the choir.
I have to tell you, we did we've been doing a bunch of virtual ensembles, and thanks to Christian's help, I mean, we've been putting together these wonderful virtual ensembles. And one of the virtual ensembles, we got together in person. So the choir records everything on their own at home for these virtual ensembles. They use their iPhone. So they get their iPhone and they record themselves singing, and then they have to record a video of themselves lip syncing. Then these amazing people that Christian supports in his business put all this stuff together in the most magical way. But for one of our performances for this last holiday concert, we decided to get our professional chamber choir together. They recorded their audio at home, and then we gathered distanced around the tree at South Coast Plaza. We had a whole camera crew and everything there, and they filmed us lip syncing. And I'm, you know, air conducting to the track that I recorded on the piano here, you know, on my computer, and then I'm air conducting to myself. Very odd. experience. But being with them and just standing there looking at them, we had to stop filming because we all became too emotional. And we weren't even really singing. We were listening to our iPhone recordings that Christian had beautifully, you know, put together in this wonderful way. But it was just like a taste of what's going to happen. And I don't think I'm emotionally prepared for that. I think I need to call a therapist right now for that moment, because it's going to be extraordinary.
No, and that's why these mixers are actually kind of special, because if it wasn't for these mixers, I wouldn't be able to see you, some of my colleagues that I've interviewed. And it's just seeing you even through this computer, it just brings back a little bit of like this hope of like, it's going to happen again soon. You're not in your tails. And you know, it's not a Segerstrom, but it's the possibility is you can see that it's just around the corner, hopefully.
It's coming. It's coming, Dennis. The vaccine is coming. People are going to support it. People are going to connect. People are going to want to be together. They're going to want to support the economy. I believe it in my heart and soul.
Right. I mean, you see all these surveys, you know, what do you want to do when you know, this COVID disappears? And a lot of people, you know, going to a concert, going to a live concert, you know, sometimes it's classical, you know, sometimes it's pop, whatever it is, you know, going to the theater, going to a musical. I mean, these are things that everyone misses so dearly. And I think everyone realizes that it's everyone's job is essential in these days. You know, when we first started saying, oh, you know, what's essential? You know, the doctors are essential. Of course, but the more and more you think about it, I realize that musicians are essential and artists are essential. And so we can't wait to be back on stage. We have just a few minutes left. Can you just end with a very short clip of something beautiful to give to our fans and our listeners today?
So I'm gonna give you a choice. I think we should watch another Pacific Symphony, Pacific Chorale.
That'll be great.
Don't you think? So I was thinking maybe we could watch, it's the first movement of Bernstein's Chichester Psalms, one of my favorite pieces. And that was on the program opening your season. It might've been the year, were you there? Was it the year that you started, began? Yeah. And it was a magical performance of this beautiful piece. So here we go. I've optimized for a video clip and I'm going to select it.
So this was actually not even planned to go this way, but I would love to end today's mixer with a quote from Bernstein. "This will be our reply to violence. to make music more intensely, more beautifully, more devotedly than ever before. I hope that everyone is safe and healthy. I hope that this past hour has been fun and informative for all of you. Thank you so much, Rob, for being my guest and our guest. And all of us look so forward to seeing you back on stage. Be healthy and be well.
You too, Dennis. Thank you so much. I adore
Thanks
you.
Thanks very much.
Yeah.
Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.